America's team, the Dallas Cowboys, trying to load up the can and get to a Super Bowl and win it. Jerry Jones, the owner of the team, desperately wants another Super Bowl, and he wants it with a team that he built, not Jimmy Johnson's team that won 3 in 4 years even after Johnson was gone as the coach. Jerry Jones wants his team to win a Super Bowl, and they've built a very good team, Chris. A lot of criticism about Jerry Jones over the years, but we have to give the Jones family praise. They have figured out a way to put together a damn good football team. The question is, based upon this offseason, relative to the other teams they're competing with, have they done enough to get closer to something they haven't done in 24 years? Play for the right to get to a Super Bowl. No NFC Championship game appearances since 1995. Do you think this is the year, based on what we've seen, that maybe they can get there?
Well, I want to piggyback off something you said, because I got it. That's where I wanted to start. I mean, the Jones family deserves a lot of credit. They really do. And I know I've given them crap about other things that have gone on in Dallas, but holy cow. I mean, holy hell, Batman. The Cowboys roster is phenomenal. I mean, they got studs all over the place. And, of course, we know the Jones family is the acting GM of the Dallas Cowboys, and they're the ones that scout these guys out and meet them and then ultimately make the pick when all said and done. And I got to give them credit for that aspect, not just owning the football team, but for what they've done. They have a true eye for talent, and that's where I'm astounded. When you look at their roster, Mike, I mean, this is one of the best teams in football on paper. They made a few additions, you know, in free agency that I think improved their football team, getting Randall Cobb at wide receiver to improve that group. You know, Robert Quinn, another pass rusher off the edge. Great. You get Jason Witten back in the fold at tight end. So all of those things are good. But at the very least, man, Mike, right? I mean, you go through their roster, you go, okay, one of the best offensive lines in football, one of the best defensive lines in football, maybe the best linebacking duo in the sport right now, arguably the best running back in the sport. You know, the corner play is up there with one of the best duos in football in Byron Jones and Chidobe Awuzie. Okay, maybe they could use a little upgrade at safety, but I don't look at Xavier Woods and Jeff Heath and go, oh my gosh, they're horrible in the back end. I go, no, those are pretty good. I can understand why they flirted with Earl Thomas and people like that. I get it. But Dallas is stacked. They got no excuse this year. There's no doubt about it. There's only one thing I worry about with the Dallas Cowboys is creativity on both sides of the ball. They got to do more on defense. We saw the Rams crack the code in the divisional playoff game, right? I know we broke it down, and I showed you a bunch of plays where, you know, yeah, they figured out some things on that Dallas defense that exposed them. On the offensive side of the ball, it can't always be about we're just going to beat you up and run downhill and out-physical you. They need to give their team a schematical advantage on the offensive side of the ball a little bit more, in my opinion. Those are the big questions. If they can make those work and give a little more creativity on both sides of the ball, I think the Dallas Cowboys are going to be in the Super Bowl conversation.
Yeah, one of the things Stephen Jones told me a couple of weeks ago, the idea that they want to be less predictable when they are lining up. They want the team to not know what's coming after the snap. And this gets back to that offensive creativity. And I saw that new offensive coordinator, Kellen Moore, and there was a lot of criticism that, you know, he's not ready, he hasn't been coaching long enough, he's going to take suggestions from the players about what they like to do offensively. You need to have that collaboration. You need to do the things the players like to do. You need to figure out what they prefer, what they don't like to do. And ultimately, the more time you can spend coming up with a system that keeps the defense guessing for as long as possible, right up until the snap, and maybe even for a beat or two after the ball is snapped, if they don't know what's coming, you are far more likely to be successful offensively.
Yeah, exactly right. I'll go back to something John Gruden always used to say, the illusion of complexity. Yeah, we might have ran this play 5 times last week. We're going to run it another 3 or 4 times this week, but we're going to make it look different with a different formation or a shift or a motion or something like that. You know, I challenge people, go back and watch the Dallas Cowboys. You very rarely see motion or shifting or anything like that. You know, it's very basic formations when they go out and line up. They usually, where they line up, they stay there throughout the snap. And yes, they depend more on just their Jimmies and their Joes, per se, as compared to their X's and their O's. They want their Jimmies and their Joes to go out there and dominate. And okay, they do it a lot. lot in Dallas, but it's the NFL and things are pretty equal out there. And you're not just going to physically steamroll every team in the NFL 16 weeks in a row. You're going to meet a few teams that are going to go, damn, okay, we're physical too. We can play this game. And then when that happens, you got to bring something else extra to the party there. And that's where I always look at Dallas and go, man, if they don't just obliterate you physically, can they match wits with you and find little ways to expose schemes on both sides of the football? That's really the big question, and I hope that they can kind of grow on both sides of the ball in that area.
You know, one of the things we talked about recently, the ability or inability to get some of these core players signed to long-term contracts. If there are guys who go into this year without new contracts, whether it's Dak Prescott, Amari Cooper, or Ezekiel Elliott, who seems to be the forgotten man in all this, does that potentially become an issue, or do they forget about that when it's time to get down to business?
Yeah, no, I think it gets forgotten about when you get down to business. Now, you know, hey, is Zeke Elliott, maybe he's 40 yards downfield and he's going, man, I might be able to smash it, you know, along the sideline here and get five more yards if I put my head down and get ready for a car crash? Or do I just step out of bounds? He might step out of bounds at this point, going, you know, okay, I'm going to save my body. I got a future to think about. So, but for the most part, no, I never saw it really filter over. I talked about it one time, I know, with you, with Brandon Marshall, where it was frustrating him at the end of the season at one point. But I never really witnessed it in any other way to where it affected players, you know, going out on a weekly basis.
When you look at their draft, they didn't have a first-round pick. Well, they did. It's Amari Cooper.
Yeah.
Tristan Hill, the defensive tackle from UCF, intrigues me because this is a guy who fell out of favor with the coaching staff at UCF, but he and Rod Marinelli established a bond, and they were all in on this guy. And, you know, we focus so much on the Ed Olivers and the Quinnen Williams, and there's a belief that Hill can be every bit as good. Think about what that could do for that defense. They've had great pass rushes. If they could get some disruption in the middle, if they could get a guy who becomes an expert in your favorite stat, the F up the play stat,
right?
That's something that could make the Cowboys a lot better in an area where the expectation may not be all that high.
Yeah, well, I mean, they're a little bit like the old Raiders with Al Davis. It's just like if you're a big, fast, strong, and, you know, a physical freak, then there's a chance that the Dallas Cowboys will want you. I mean, at the base level, that seems like what they are a little bit. And I love them for that, and that's why they've accumulated such a great roster. But, hey, Mike, you're spot on with the Tristan Hill thing. I mean, he has first-round attributes. It's just, hey, the film was a little all over the place at times, maybe, you know, wanting you to want more here and there. And, yeah, I know he had a few issues off the field with the coaching staff or whatever it may be. But Rod Marinelli, he was a defensive line coach when I was with the Tampa Bay Buccaneers. Man, I don't know if there's a better defensive line coach in football than him and his ability to, you know, for lack of a better phrase, I mean, he can get the defensive lineman to eat out of his hand, right? I mean, he's just that good to where they want to do anything for him. I saw Warren Sapp and Simeon Rice and, you know, Booger McFarland. They would have ran through a wall for Rod Marinelli. That's how much they loved him and what he did. And he just has that magic about him where he can be tough on you, but shows he cares about you and he gets the most out of those players. And I think Tristan Hill is a guy who has big-time talent, like Pro Bowl-type talent, and he's the type of guy that can maybe get it out of him.
Why is it considered a good thing to have someone eat out of your hand or like an animal or a pet or something?
I know. Yeah.
That's not a desirable thing. Where did that phrase ever come from? I guess it's more a sign of the submission.
Right? Submit or the great ability to leader and be a leader and the trust. Right, exactly. I know. As I was saying it, I was going, you know, am I like demeaning anybody here with that? I was like actually thinking about that as I was saying it.
I think it's an appropriate phrase.
Yeah, right.
I just wonder why in the hell it's supposedly a good thing to have someone eat out of your hand. I've tried it with my dog. It's not pleasant. All right. We're gonna take a we're not gonna take a break. Before we take the break, we're gonna take a look at the Cowboys win total projected by the folks at the Westgate Superbook. Nine. Are we over? Are we under? Are we right on nine for the Cowboys?
No, I'm going over. I think right now, I think it's gonna be a fight between them and the Philadelphia Eagles to win the NFC East. I think if I had a pick right now, I'm picking both teams to go to the playoffs. And yes, I'm thinking over nine. I'm thinking 10-6, 11-5 type year for the Dallas Cowboys.
Yeah, I think the Eagles are going to win that division this year. I think the Cowboys could get a wild card berth, but that's not going to lay the foundation to get back to the NFC Championship game. And one thing we didn't mention, the pressure, the relentless pressure on Jason Garrett, the head coach, entering the final year of his contract. Will he be the coach in 2020? Yes or no?
I'm going to say yes. I think they're going to make a deep run. I'm going to go with it this year. I do. I don't know why, but I feel something good about this Dallas football team. I think the addition of Amari Cooper and some of the things they did, Randall Cobb in free agency, is going to give that offense enough this year to where it's not always going to have to be about Ezekiel Elliott beating teams up physically and Dak Prescott making an amazing physical type play to get them over the edge. I think they're going to be able to win in a few different ways this year. It's going to be a lot on Kellen Moore to see what he can bring to the table on the offensive side of the ball, though.
Here's my guess.
Yeah.
I'll say yes that Jason Garrett will be the coach in 2020, but
right.
with this caveat, it's going to be a two-year deal, which is essentially a one-year deal. It's going to be a one-year deal with a one-year team option. It's going to be sold as a two-year deal, but he's not going to get a five-year contract. It's going to be a short-term, all right, you made it to the playoffs. Maybe they get to the divisional round. I don't think they're getting to the NFC Championship game, but it was enough that Jerry Jones isn't going to want to throw him out and start over again. And also, they're going to want to wait one more year to get Sean Payton. I think that's I still think that that specter is looming, and I know Saints fans hate it when I say it, but I think that's a factor in all this. But right now, my guess is Garrett's going to find a way to stick around for at least one more year after this year.
Hi, I'm Mike Tirico, and thanks for watching. Make sure to hit subscribe for the latest news and highlights from NBC Sports.